Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams, One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and providing the knowledge are Alan Temple.
Hello.
George Cran.
Hello.
And Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
Right down to business. Although, actually, before we start about team matters, I suppose we really should send our best wishes to former Dundee player Eddie Anand, who's battling very serious illness just now. I remember Eddie from his time at Dens as a quiet but nice lad and a boy who scored a few valuable goals. So we're all thinking about him, and hopefully he can battle through. And talking of battling through, George, Dundee did so against Motherwell with a draw that was well deserved.
Wasn't sure if you were going to talk about the players or the groundsman.
Yes, the staff as well. It seems to be it happened with Scotland earlier this summer. It seems to be a new thing. Water on the pitch no longer matters.
Let's get the brushes out.
Because so, I have to say, it cost the water. For me, cost Dundee. There was a ball that didn't bounce in midfield. Motherwell went up the park and scored a very good goal. But it did start. Had that been a normal dry pitch, which nobody can do anything about the weather, it would have been Dundee in possession.
It was a bizarre day because in the morning it was torrential in Dundee. I was concerned the game was going to be off. They were speaking to the SPFL about a possible postponement on the first day of the season, which is remarkable, really. And then it seemed to ease off, and then as soon as the referee blew the whistle, the heavens opened again, and you could see the two Bryans with the brushes out throughout the entire first half. The referee had to stop the game at one point so they could take a corner, because they were still pushing the water off that troublesome corner. But credit to them, they got the game on. And yeah, Dundee got a deserved point in the end. They probably could have won it. It was fairly even, but I think on the balance of chances, Dundee probably edged it. Scoring goals is still a bit of an issue. There's only one game this season they've scored more than one goal, but they showed a bit of fight. Lyle Cameron came up with a goal in his Premiership debut. Shows that he's not finished after a great season last season. Plenty to be happy about and plenty to be positive about going forward. I think they wanted that win on the first home game of the season, but they'll take it.
I think they'll be right. The big thing they've learned painfully in the past is not losing your first game. Mm-hmm. And also playing well, which they did.
They did play well. I mean, you go and you've got to tick a lot of boxes when you get up to the Premier League. First thing, can you score a goal? Did that. Can you get a point on the board? Did that. Can you get a win on the board? Mm-hmm. Still got to do that. Can you get a win away from home? Still got to do that. There's loads of things that I've got to... You can't tick them all off in one game. But there were more, as George says, there were more pluses and minuses in that performance. They were a bit unfortunate early doors because Portal, his first jump, he wins the ball in the air and comes down. I think he just jarred his knee or something.
Yeah, that's what I thought. He'd been in the tackle because he'd... The manager said he jumped and he landed awkwardly. But then there was a tackle with Wilkinson, I think, and I thought it was the tackle that did it. Maybe it was a combination of the both.
Yeah, yeah. But it was unfortunate. He had to go off after about 6 minutes. So it meant a reshuffle, and Mr. Versatile, Jordan McGee, goes over to the right-hand side. And they were still playing a three, but I looked at a wee bit unbalanced three. Beck was still wanting to attack on the left, but Ashcroft had gone over to the left side of defence, and the right, I thought it could have even been a 4-4-2, it looked a bit at times, the way it was set up, but they got by it, to be fair, because the last thing you want to do in the first game, Tom, is change your defence, but these things happen in football, and they had to go and do it. I was impressed with Motherwell. We hadn't heard a lot about them. We talked about Dundee beefing themselves up. I thought Motherwell were a bigger side than Dundee. That shows, you know, where this Premier League is, you need big players. But I thought that over the course of the game, Motherwell looked a bit more in control when they had the ball. But Dundee did more with the ball when they were actually in control. You know what I mean? They created better chances. And, you know, you're right enough about the first goal, the goal they lose, because Ashcroft goes for the ball and it just does not bounce.
Yeah.
It goes under his foot and Motherwell are quickly on attack. What I couldn't understand was for the life of me, Malachi Boateng, Motherwell are in possession, and Stephen O'Donnell, Malachi Boateng has a player in, directly in front of him who he's marking, but Stephen O'Donnell bakes past him up the right-hand side. Malachi Boateng does not follow that run. Mm-hmm. And of course, the ball gets chipped out right. O'Donnell puts a terrific ball into the box, and fair play to Theo Bear. I gave him a bit of criticism last week. I said it's a bit of a panic sign from Motherwell, but he finished it really well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a cracking finish, wasn't it?
The net.
They could have, I think, a more experienced midfielder as well, because it was quite a very young midfield at that point, because Morgan had come in, they'd have fouled in the middle.
I think so.
They'd have just killed
There's a bit of that, and you learn from these things, and I'm sure that Tony Docherty will be pointing out, you know, where they went wrong in that situation. But, you know, there's sure a lot of determination in the second half. Leo Cameron got man of the match, but for me, Luke McKibben was the top performer for Dundee. He did a really good shift over on that right hand side. And we've spoken about Luke McKibben.
I was going to say, because we've dealt him.
Yes,
you've got that ability. Do it most weeks.
He can be a game changer for Dundee this season, but he needs to produce week in, week out. He does it, you know, obviously he does it once every four games. He needs to get that ratio up. But he puts over a great ball for
fairness to him. He's starred two league games in a row now.
No, that's
a great start in the promotion game.
And when you're playing with sort of, you know, a 3-5-2, he has defensive duties as well. And he stuck to that quite well. Really, he'd hit the post earlier on. Great ball for the goal. If you watch Cameron, Cameron makes it. If you watch Cameron's run, he goes into the middle and then quickly reverses backwards out and doesn't get picked up by any defenders and comes around the back post. And it shows you don't have to be 6'4" to score a goal with your head, and he put it away well.
Is that where it helps when you've not got the height advantage?
Possibly.
Because you have to
think so.
He was thinking of losing people because he knows he's not going to win.
And
I also think,
Tom, when defenders and even midfielders are defending that 6-yard box, they're not too concerned about where Leo Cameron is. They're looking,
looking for the big guys.
Yeah, and it helps that Dundee have two big strikers as well, the centre-backs.
Yeah.
Muller were concerned with that.
They get the goal. They're a wee bit unlucky, one off the post. I thought, I think it was a guy Muller had a shot for them late on, which was going on target.
And Joe
Shaughnessy put his head on it and knocked it wide for a corner. And Dundee got a goal kick. Actually, he didn't even spot that it had been deflected wide. So I think, a lot of pluses for Dundee. I think we need to see a bit more from Robinson and Bakayoko up front.
Yeah, I didn't think Bakayoko. I thought he looked a little bit off the pace. He looked maybe.
But all in all, you've got to feel...
It's a player that hasn't played that much.
At the end, I think the crowd were quite satisfied that they're back in. They got that goal, they got their point. Yeah. They're on the board in the Premier League and looking forward to Paisley this weekend.
Yeah. And Alan, people tend to look at names and not current reputations. Motherwell, this is not a stat I came up with, but Motherwell have only lost 2-19 now. And also I heard, I think it was Stephen Craigan was at the game when I was listening on the radio. Obviously, ex-Motherwell has an interest, sees them a lot. And he made the point, Motherwell are very good at having games, and not just spells in games, where you would say they were not the team that was on top, but they don't lose. So it's a decent result for Dundee. I'm not going to go overboard about it, but coming away with a point where the perception was they were the better team if somebody was going to win it. So it's an encouraging start.
Absolutely. And getting off the mark.
You, of course, saw one of those defeats that Motherwell suffered under Stuart Kettlewell.
Yes. One of the kind of, I would say, five or six maybe real false dawns last season. That seemed so positive after that. But no, it's getting off the mark is so pivotal. It might seem daft, but you lose your first home game, then you've got an away game.
Yeah.
Every chance, that's a tough one. Before you know it, you're maybe two or three games in and you've not got a point on the board. So it's vital. And I mean, I've obviously just, you know, seen the highlights. You guys will have seen much more of the actual action and the back and forth. But I thought the quality of chances that Dundee created was excellent. You know, Motherwell have been indebted to the woodwork there. So I think on another day, I think Dundee won that football match. And you guys have touched really ably on a lot of the positives. But one thing I did enjoy on the Lyle Cameron point that you were making, really enjoyed watching him last season, just for the fact that he's almost got a striker's instinct of timing his runs into the box. Mm-hmm. He just, you know, it's all easy to say kind of, oh, he's small, so people don't pick him up. But there's plenty of small players that don't find the space that Lyle Cameron does. See, for such a young man...
Bear's talking about defenders he played behind. There are also diligent defenders who try to mark everybody.
Yeah. But he's got a real intelligent appreciation of space that usually only comes maybe when you're a wee bit older. I mean, this podcast is now becoming sort of the podcast where we make ludicrous comparisons, so let's just carry that on. And it's a wee bit Frank Lampardy, you know, and Lyle Cameron. See that knack that he's got of just popping up in the right place at the right time. Obviously, I'm not comparing the two players, but just on that particular attribute. And the exciting thing is that will only get better. He'll only learn when's the right time to go, when's the right time to stay. And that's probably why, you know, earlier this season, there's maybe been games where it wasn't quite as impactful, because people need to find those runs, you know, mm-hmm. people, and there will be days where he's ineffectual, there'll be days where he's, it's not his day. But when you look at that, when you look at the timing of that run, and he did it so often last season as well, yeah. I think there's really something there to work on, and I still think he needs to build himself physically a little bit more, but that will come with time. And I think he needs to impact on games when he isn't maybe being found as much as he would like. Mm-hmm. Again, that's an improvement you would think would come with time, but that's an exciting aspect of his performance. I just think it's funny when we're talking about the physicality and the importance of being as strong as teams, the smallest player in the park pops up with a header. It's a funny game.
I was just having a look at a wee stat for Lyle Cameron. It's quite interesting. 15 goals, 29 starts.
Brilliant.
I mean, that's pretty good, isn't it?
Striking numbers.
Yeah.
That's pretty sold soon, if you ask me. When's the end of August? But George, to put my doomsday D hat on.
We do need it, yeah.
They should have scored more. They should have scored more the week
it's
before.
It's been a problem,
against Inverness. I mean, the plus side is they're creating, but they're too many games like that. Heads will go down a wee bit. Also, I was happy with a point on the first day. As a fan, I would have taken that, especially given Motherwell's current situation. They're a very difficult team to beat. Dundee go to St Mirren on Saturday. They had a great win at Easter Road on Sunday. Statistically, a team like Dundee gets beat more often than the win away from home in the Premier League. Then they've got Hearts at home. Now they want to take the good work and get a win quickly, don't they?
Yeah, definitely. Because I was having a look back at 2 years ago when they were last in the Premiership. Because I remember the first game of the season was at Dens against St Mirren, an established Premiership team, and they came away with a draw that day. Joe Shaughnessy actually scored an own goal for St Mirren, or for Dundee, whichever way. It was a Dundee goal. But then they were quite happy with that, but then didn't win a league game until October. And we saw what happened by the end of the season. That was a real struggle. I'm not saying it's going to be the same this time around, because the team looks like it's got much more quality in it this time around. But it just... You need that win as soon as possible on the board. You don't want to be looking at the league table and continually being at the bottom of it. But in terms of the goals, that has been the issue for quite a while now. Because, I mean, the five games this season, only one of them they've scored more than one goal. That was against Dumbarton. You look a wee bit further back, the couple of friendlies at Cove and Arbroath were just 1-0 wins. The goals haven't exactly been flowing, but to turn that on its head, at the other end, they've not been conceding many. Conceded one at Airdrie, one against Motherwell, and one against the Barton.
So missed a start.
I've been channeling the inner Ewan Smith since he's been sunning himself in Mexico. So
yes.
Are we supposed to do research for this podcast?
News to me.
So they're not conceding.
Spoiling it, George.
Yeah, sorry.
You're sounding knowledgeable. Stop it.
They're not conceding goals, so that's a good sign of things. Obviously, that'll be tested at St Mirren. They're looking pretty good and have goals in them. Have to keep Mark O'Hara quiet. Yeah.
Strange team, yeah. St Mirren. I saw their lineup ahead of Easter Road, and up front on his own plays a guy who didn't exactly set the header alight on loan at Arbroath last season. And
who I thought his name was actually Lasagna every time I heard it.
That must have been awful disappointing for you. And then they score three goals. So they're still clearly a very capable attacking unit there, but I don't think it's necessarily due to their strikers. I don't think they've got a great striker pool. You can tell by the amount of them that Stephen Robinson seems to be signing, but behind them. I think they've got some really good creative players. Yeah. I've liked Greg Kelly from the moment he was on loan at Dunfermline, and he was just lighting up games.
He's just trying to scare us, George.
And Mark O'Hara's a top player. They've done so well with holding on to Mark O'Hara. And yeah,
which Dundee might have done a few years ago.
Yeah. I'm surprised he's still at a club at that tier, if that makes sense. You know, I would say St Mirren, Dundee, kind of akin to each other in terms of their tier of football. And I could see Mark O'Hara comfortably playing for a team that you would generously maybe consider to be a slightly higher tier, maybe, you know, a Hibs or a Hearts or something like that, because his numbers are fabulous.
I thought he was excellent at Dundee. I was a massive fan.
I've even thought for a few years, players like him, more strikers like Lauren Shankland, I don't understand. I think the Old Firm could save themselves a bit of money by identifying players that certainly would do a job for them in the league.
When you look at
part of their squad.
When you look at O'Hara's engine and energy and physicality, he could do a job down in England and probably double his money. Yeah. So that's kind of surprising as well.
He
left Dundee for Peterborough. It was a good contract. And they scored a bunch of goals right at the start. He did brilliant. And then just faded.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe the game just didn't suit him or what, but it certainly suits him up here.
But on Saturday, Bear, in your position, St Mirren could well be facing one of their they will be facing Joe Shaughnessy, but they could be facing another star of last season's campaign for them, Trevor Carson.
It could be, but that's a big decision for Tony Docherty to make, I've got to say, because John McCracken had a good game at the weekend. He pulled off a fantastic save from Blair Spittle down low in the first half and never did anything wrong. So that's a big conversation Tony Docherty would have with McCracken if he's going to bring Trevor Carson right in. And to be fair, I'll be interested to see if he changes the team in general, because he's a rare breed of manager. He never put a substitute on after that sixth minute.
No, I know. That's strange.
Very unusual in a Premier League game.
And Motherwell only made two, I think.
Yeah, very unusual. Yeah. You obviously had faith in the players that were on the park. Maybe didn't want to disrupt it at a time when they were doing okay defensively. Just didn't want to throw someone on that could upset. You know, you're talking about maybe getting a winner, but if you throw someone on it, because sometimes upset the defensive aspect of play.
Maybe.
But it'll also be interesting to see if he goes with two up top, which would be big in the Premier League as well, for an away side like Dundee just being promoted and playing with the two strikers. You know, so a lot of questions. But in terms of the goalkeeper, I think it's crystal clear that Trevor Carson is going to be number one. It just depends how long, you know, he has to wait to get his hands on the gloves.
And he's obviously, he had to reshuffle the team on Saturday after Portales got injured, and he's got that to think about. You said it looked a bit unbalanced.
I just think that Owen Beck is a natural to play as a wing-back, in a wing-back role, but he also defends very well down that left-hand side. And I think I liked McGee on the right side of defence because he didn't really want to go... He didn't get himself hauled away out of position. I think that Ashcroft sometimes feels he's duty-bound to step it over there. So I felt at times it looked a bit like a 4-4-2. I know it was still... I mean, McCown was still wide right, effectively, and still had two strikers on, but at times it looked to me
he's
like
quite
like a 4-4-2. Yeah. So, there's a couple of things he could change in it. You know, I mean, McGee's well comfortable with playing it on the right-hand side of the defence, either as a right centre-back or... You know,
He's played a few. In fact, Dundee are the club that moved him into midfield more than anyone else, more than Hearts or Falkirk ever did.
Yeah.
Well, you look at him, and obviously it was Mulligan that came on, but between the two of them, they can pretty much cover every position apart from striker and goalkeeper, I think, between the two of them. So
I've got to mention Mulligan as well. I mean,
he was excellent.
He was really ghosting past boys. I mean, that surface was like glue, and he was just ghosting past boys. One thing that let him down was his final ball and his finishing touch. You know, but if that comes again, you know, Dundee will be quids in.
And Tony Docherty's still looking for players. There's a trio of midfielders linked in the past couple of days.
Certainly wants, some reinforcements in there. Obviously, Sean Burton.
You can name them if you want, John.
I'll get this. Obviously, Sean Burton's left to go on loan to Raith Rovers. Mm-hmm. Had a lot of options. Basically, the whole championship wanted him. But he's chosen Raith Rovers, and
good signing for Raith Rovers.
I think so. So they're looking at that kind of somebody to play alongside Boateng, I think, in the middle. And the names, Tyler Onyango from Everton, young midfielder, highly rated. The story in the Courier, the Tilly.
Oh my God, there's a yellow card.
No. That St Johnstone had said no to moving on with possibly signing him, but Dundee were still interested, and Tony Docherty confirmed that at the weekend. Killian Phillips from Crystal Palace looks a very good player, but it doesn't look like that one's going to happen. Tony Docherty speaking yesterday kind of indicated that, and it looks like he's going to Wickham. So I could probably strike him off the list. And just last night and this morning, Sean Goss is one that's emerged as a possible. Obviously, played a lot up here with Motherwell and Rangers and St Johnstone. Bit more experienced than the rest of the team. That's obviously something we've talked about.
I was going to say that. Looking at Dundee, one thing I think in the middle of the park, apart from Jordan McGee, they're quite young.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the natural ability of the other two, although George seems to have killed the boy Phillips, stone dead.
Well, I think he's still alive, but just in England.
He's dead to us if he doesn't come. But would you be tempted to go for Goss just on the basis that adds, as well as a bit of quality, it adds experience?
Yeah, we talked about Joe Shaughnessy coming in, Trevor Carson, two players with Premier League experience. If you get someone you know who can do a job at that level, then as a box ticked in terms of, in addition to the squad, but, you know, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I still think they need, what I remember is Sean Goss, he's an experienced guy, he's a tough tackling midfielder. I think he would be positive, but I still think we need a more creative, experienced midfielder in there. I think we're relying too much on Lyle Cameron, we're relying a wee bit too much on Luke McCowan to produce somebody that can go in and can
Paul McGinn.
I've said that.
Yeah.
Not Paul McGinn. Coming from Cove Rangers at 35, but someone of that ilk.
And Paul McGinn suspended. in fantastic Paul McGinn fashion. He got sent off on his debut. Yeah.
Gouser will be back. Not a Dense, but he'll be back for Cove Rangers, I'm sure. No, but someone of that sort of stature who is quite comfortable taking the ball in tight areas and can see when a game, a Kevin Thompson type character. I mean, we're punching quite high here, I've got to say, but that sort of experience that I think is acquired, that sort of talent would be a massive boost to Dundee.
Yeah, I have to say, Alan Baird just described a player there that's going to cost well into seven figures, if you ask me.
Yeah, it's clear with the fact that if there's a strong interest there in Sean Goss, what they're maybe after, which is they've got their Malachi Boateng, they've got Jordan McGee, they've got people that can make tackles, and they've got people that can do hard running. And Sean Goss, what you've got is a guy who, from set pieces, you've got a wand of a delivery, he can play passes. For me, and, you know, happy if he wants to come and prove me wrong, but I don't think he affects football matches enough. I think he flatters to deceive too much as a player. His most effective games for Motherwell were certainly his deliveries, screamer of a goal at Easter Road against Hibs. I think so. He does catch the eye, he does flashy things, but I worry that in a team that might not always dominate the football, as Dundee probably won't, I don't know if Sean Goss is the guy for the trenches in the midfield. But as I say, Tony Docherty is far, 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 far more qualified to make that decision than me. And if he thinks he's the man, then he might very well come in and be the man. But he probably wouldn't have been top of my list, and I think he veers too much. It's a great comparison in terms of the Kevin Thompson. Kevin Thompson was a player who was wonderfully technically gifted, could pick a pass, could cut teams open. But see, when you didn't have the ball, he was a terrier. And
I was going to say, Kevin Thompson would have had 50 Scotland caps plus if he'd have been fit during his career. He read a game beautifully, didn't he?
You need someone who can do a bit of both, and Sean Goss would just, I think he would need a bit more kind of work in terms of that time without the ball if he was going to be that, you know, Kevin Thompson type. But I think he would be very talented when you've got the football. It's just how often Dundee necessarily have the football every week would be my only concern.
Yeah, that's where I would actually, for once, disagree with Bear and say they've got enough players that are good with the football. I must admit, my idea of what I'd like to see Dundee sign in the middle of the park is a Kevin Thompson off the ball.
It puts a
type
puts,
player who's prepared to sit and knows when to go and not go. And
it just puts a bit of pressure on Malachi Boateng. I would have thought if you've got a player beside him that maybe doesn't luxuriate in doing the defensive stuff, it means Boateng and potentially McGee, if they're playing a three in there, have to do a lot of work.
I think what I would like to see is something similar to McGee in terms of the running ability and getting around the pitch and that defensive nose, but with a wee bit more quality on the ball. I think we know McGee's a good player, but he's not going to cut a defence open, or he's not going to make that pass that creates space for a goal. But he's a hard worker who does all the dirty stuff. A bit of that and a wee bit more on the ball, I think. So if he could meld Sean Goss and Jordan McGee together.
But that goes back to exactly what Tam was saying. That player we describe as an exceptionally expensive footballer. So maybe you do go with a Sean Goss, and as a good coach, back yourself to get more out of him defensively, which is maybe there is more to come. Maybe Sean Goss at previous clubs has never been asked to do that other side of the game as much.
Look at Jordan McGee. He was signed as a centre-half stroke right-back. Look at the job he's done for Dundee in midfield.
Yep, so maybe there's more to come, and it would be exciting if Tony Docherty was the guy to unlock that.
And also, I mean, Tyler French is back in training, George. It's been a long time. How far away is he? Because he would give them that option of putting McGee back in midfield.
It's still maybe a couple of weeks away. I think I saw him when I arrived at the end. He was on the pitch with Charlie Riley. They were both doing running drills and stuff, so it's positive. Manager was talking about possibly seeing him in the Dundee B game next week. They're playing in the Challenge Cup, so he might possibly play some part in that. And then they're playing a bounce game, and they've got a free weekend next week because it's League Cup and they're not in that anymore. So they're organising a game and he should get some minutes in there. So it won't be too far away once this wee break comes and passes, but I'm really interested to see how he does stepping up from the Championship. I thought he was absolutely excellent last season. It adds so much pace to your back line. It's a real asset. Where he plays, I don't know. Obviously, they've got a couple of defensive issues at the moment with Portales. Looks like he's going to be out for a fair amount of time.
We're being very upbeat about Dundee and rightly so, and maybe it's credit to them as well, because they are carrying a few, but Portales out now. Aaron Donnelly's been out since early pre-season training.
He looks like he's going to be a wee while.
Charlie Riley, that's the other end of the park, admittedly. Yeah. And he might be more one for the future. But there have been a few injuries for them to cope with.
Particularly at the back. And if Tony Docherty is going to continue with the three that he likes, that obviously means you need an extra centre-back. And being a couple down is an issue. Or three down, if you count Tyler French, not quite been ready yet.
He's also got Cammy Kerr.
And he mentioned that.
He's not been starting, but there's certainly games like Saturday, for instance, and games against the biggest team. Cammy's defensive qualities are never in question.
Absolutely. And it's definitely an option, because I did look at the bench when Portales was limping about and I was thinking, oh, there's not really a centre-back on there, but obviously McGee was on the pitch. But that's Cammy.
George is for those who don't know George, that's like a major crisis. When George says, it's like there's a typhoon coming or something like that. It's not a gentle breeze. George is quite a laid-back chap, for those of you who don't know.
Obviously, Donnelly was one they had really high hopes for. Tony Docherty spoke really highly of him, but it looks like he's going to be at least into the months. I think he's going to be out. And he was the one.
What's he done with himself?
He turned his ankle, basically first day of training. Apparently, his family were up at the game on Saturday, though. He couldn't travel because of his injury, but the family came up anyway. So, tells you he's keen.
I'm always interested in that, especially I can understand if you're dealing with part-time clubs, or even if the laddie's sitting injured in a hotel abroad. But I'm always interested as to why clubs loan a player to another full-time club with proper medical staff. As soon as they get injured, they get back down here. We want to see what they've done to you, son. Because he is doing his rehab in Nottingham.
He's back there in Nottingham, yeah.
I mean, surely in an ideal world, a lone player, you would have him mixing with his temporary teammates, if you like, because at least get to know them a bit better.
Well, maybe that'll happen further down the line. They are a Premier League club, so I'm sure they've got decent.
They'll have medical. More physios than Dundee. They do have about 50 players, not on Forest, so they must have a big medical team to go with that.
And he's a left-sided defender. I think you're talking about balance in the back three. I think he was going to be a big part of that, playing on the left side of the three. Patala's, how long that'll be, I haven't found out the full extent yet. Did see him leaving Gardine with a knee brace on, so that doesn't
look
great.
Heard there was mechanical devices strapping around his leg.
Yeah. So, yeah, that could be a wee while. It's a ligament issue. So it's a shame for the boy. 6 minutes into your Premiership debut and it's an injury like that. But hopefully it won't be too long.
Thank goodness there's a Taco Bell in the city centre now. free advert. Yeah. That's the one to pay me.
Anyway. That's unfortunate, isn't it? It's just here and he's on the treatment table straight away. It's disappointing because... He does look a good defensive option for them. Every game I've seen him, I think he looks a bit on the small side. That's compared to Ashcroft and Shaughnessy. And a lot of guys would look on the small side compared to those two, but I don't think I've seen him lose a header in the air. So
that's because he only played for 6 minutes.
Played a couple of other games.
It's hard to lose a header when you're on a stretcher.
Yeah.
Anyway, great stuff.